For an order form to obtain the notes that go with this series, phone this number at any time, 01991 8031. We'll be video active in about 2 minutes from now. Until then, some music. BBC2, here's an introductory guide to making home videos. So strike a light, because we're video active.
Welcome once again to the EV Video Show. The letter that's got everything and nothing. Well, you're welcome anyway. Come in.
Hello, and welcome to EBTV. This is the show that goes out when everybody else does. Who can blame them?
Davy, it's 6 months since I last sent you a tape letter, and it's longer than that since you sent me one, so you obviously owe me a tape. I won't hold that against you, because I've got a few bits and pieces that we've filmed during the course of the year, our Malta holiday, and some windsurfing down on the marina, which ended up as a film. It was meant to be just a little insert for you, but ended up as a proper film. I'm going to put that in for you, and we've got a mystery piece a bit later on. Should amuse you. For the moment, we bought a new suite.
Eric Billington's first job 34 years ago aroused a passion in him that's lasted to this day. The job was as a projectionist in a local cinema, and the passion was for making movies. On the streets of Crosby near Liverpool, Eric Billington has become a familiar figure. With the introduction of home video cameras, Eric's passion has taken a new direction, and few of his friends and relatives escape the results.
Eric, you've got quite an unusual hobby here. How did you hit on the idea of video letters?
It was a throwback from audio cassette letters, and that was a throwback in turn from bad writing, bad handwriting. I don't like writing letters, and I think you can get more personality into a voice, and then from logical conclusion from that was that face would be even better still. Well, the father and mother are still okay. Children Bob are fine. Susan and Colin and the family, they're okay. They're away on holiday. And Heather and Adrian are away on holiday with their two kids in Devon at the moment. So if they bring any decent photographs back, then I'll put them on the next tape for you.
They developed into video magazines. A little bit of me, a little bit of film taken from outside. If we'd been, say the family had been out for the day, they know my family via video. They've never met them in person, but they know them through the TV screen.
As soon as his wife leaves the house for work, Eric transforms his living room into a full-blown studio. All he needs is his camera and recorder, some lights, a separate microphone, and a TV monitor so he can see how he looks on screen.
Hello, Davey. It's 6 months since I last sent you a tape letter, and it's longer than that since you sent me one, so you obviously owe me a tape. I won't hold that against you.
With the remote control from the camera, Eric can turn himself on and off and check his recordings without moving from the presenter's chair.
Which ended up as a film. It was meant to be just a little
insert. His studio area is actually very small, but when he wants to vary the shot and show more of the room, he uses his wide-angle lens.
Should amuse you. It's one which I bought from a photographic shop. It's just a simple wide-angle adapter for a 35mm camera. And all I do is put it on the front of my own video camera, and it widens the room by twice. For the moment, we bought a new suite. And as you can't see it where the camera is, I'm not going to alter the whole studio setup. So what I'll do is,
I'll pop the wide-angle lens on, and you can see where the last lot of money went to.
Went on this rather nice cottage suite, so things are looking up.
Now, what I'm going to do, first of all, is I'm going to introduce you to my surprise, which is some very old film that we found in America. And it's me at 11 years of age, Susan at 2, and the beach as it used to be. So, Davy, that was what I looked like 40 years ago. There's been no improvement.
Although it's fun, you've got quite an impressive-looking light setup. Will you just sort of talk me through it?
Yeah, well, basically, you can just flood the room with one light, but you get no shadows and no interest in the faces. So what I've done, I've got two domestic light fittings, which you buy from any good store, electrical store, that clip onto the furniture. You put 100-watt reflectors, silver-backed reflectors in them. That gives you your background and fill light. And then on two of the stands over here, there's 150 and 100 on there, silver-backed lamps again, which are just fitted into two old chandelier fittings, which are put atop two metal frames, which were cheap screen stands that I bought at a sale for 30 bob each. And I just adapted them, knocked the old screens off because they were broken, fitted the chandelier fittings, the metal tubing, into the top of the lights, and then you just use the ordinary bayonet cap lamp in the top of them. They're, of course, they're adjustable for height, as for professional stuff. And it didn't cost, the whole thing, I suppose, cost £5 for the two. And you can adjust them, move them around the room as you want.
The lighting Eric uses can be applied to any setup. Using lights can make a real difference to the quality of a video. So let's look at their effects in more detail. This is what I looked like with just one powerful light pointing straight at me. You can't see my features very clearly. Everything looks a bit flat. If you turn up the sensitivity on the camera, you overexpose. That's those white patches. If you turn it down, all you get is a mucky splodge. The problem with the TV screen is that it's flat, and if you show a picture on it that doesn't have any shadows, then it looks even flatter. The trick is to acquire depth by creating shadows and using different lighting levels. So let's see what happens when we move our light. Now all the light is coming from one lamp over to one side. This is the main one, so we'll call it the key light. This lights up my face so you can see all the features, but it also creates too much shadow down one side of the face. It looks very dramatic, but it's not very useful. So how do we get rid of these strong, distracting shadows? Well, it's easy. We put another light, a fill light, on the other side to soften them. But don't make this light as powerful as the key light, or you're almost back to square one. Remember, as well as just seeing the whole face, we want to create depth by having different lighting levels. Well, now the face is properly lit, but we still have a problem. With just two strong lights directed onto the face, you run the risk of merging into the background, or in the case of a very dark room like this, of just not seeing any background at all. The solution? Simply throwing some light onto the background. Now both myself and the background are properly lit, and the whole picture has that feeling of depth. Now, we've used proper film lights, but what do you do if your only extra light is a single video lamp at home? This room is probably more like your own living room, except that we can make everything much brighter by switching on that video lamp there, fitted with a 1000 watt bulb. You have to experiment to find the best position for it, but it's usually a good idea to bounce it off the ceiling or into a corner, wherever it's white or very light. As you can see, it's much better than using no lights, and there is some shadowing, but it still looks pretty flat. So we add another lamp to highlight one side of the face. Now you can see real contrasts, and the picture looks more interesting. If you add a couple more domestic lamps, you can change the background lighting to get a really full effect with plenty of depth. The key lamp we used to create the highlights is just an ordinary desk lamp, except that instead of a 60-watt bulb, we fitted a 275-watt photo flood, which obviously makes it much brighter. But remember, if you do use a photo flood, not to leave it on for too long or the whole lamp will overheat. Again, you have to experiment to find the best position. Just keep fiddling and moving it around and looking at the TV screen until you get the effect that you want. And really, these two lamps on their own should be perfectly adequate because the video lamp itself will provide some general background lighting. Obviously, if you can add a couple of extra background lights, all well and good because it'll give you that extra depth. And we've used a couple of desk lamps with ordinary light bulbs in them. But you could get some interesting effects if you were to use, say, coloured light bulbs. Now, so far, this has all been about getting lighting right. But let's just see what would happen if we were to play around with it a little bit.
I say, isn't this exciting?
In this setup, all the light is coming from above and it's making me look quite small and weak. All the detail has gone from the eyes and underneath the chin, and there's a distinct feeling of claustrophobia. Lighting from below gives quite an eerie impression. The shadows on the cheeks accentuate the eyes, and the effect is to make me more dominating and evil. You can do lots with light to create mood and atmosphere, so don't be afraid to experiment. The makers of this video have made exceptional use of backlighting to create ghostly characters. Effect, a single 500-watt lamp was placed at the far end of a smoke-filled tunnel behind the actors playing the ghosts.
Hello.
Simmons belongs to a group of enthusiasts who've restored an old steam engine in a sawmill in Oxfordshire. When making a promotional video about the engine, Richard found he was faced with some particularly challenging lighting problems.
It is very dim and gloomy in there, and there are lots of different levels to the place. I knew that when a film crew films things, they light it, but I'd had no experience at all. My own experience was with sound recording, so we were starting from scratch, really. We optimistically set out with two domestic electric light bulbs in reflectors, and this looked quite good in the little viewfinder on the camera, but when we played back the day's shooting after we'd finished, it was very poor colour, and there were lots of grainy spots on it, and everywhere where the camera or the people moved, it left long smears behind. So effectively, it was just rubbish. We had to scrap the lot. We were a bit heartbroken at that stage. Well, obviously, we had to reshoot it, so I went to a photographer friend of mine and said, look, can you lend me some lights? And what he gave me, in fact, was some photoflood lamps in reflectors. We only had two of these, so we had to do the best we could with just two lamps on stands. And one of the problems is in here, there's hardly any level places to put stands, so where we put them was more or less where we could. We really just wanted it light all over, and we hoped that that would light up the engine in an interesting way. The main thing really was to get the whole thing light, and that's quite difficult with only two lights. The pictures were okay, and the colour was okay and so on, but again, we could have done with even more light because the moving parts, for example, the governor that goes round, tended to look rather ghostly because the image on the camera was smeared. And I think if we'd had more lights, that would have cured it. But we didn't really know how to go about getting more light at the time.
It is possible to hire lights from video workshops or theatrical lighting stores. We asked our own cameraman how he would light the steam engine. He recommended lighting it from all sides and used six redheads, 800-watt lamps, which are widely available. Wherever possible, they were clamped to the ceiling for safety and were then covered with blue gels, also available from hire shops, to colour balance them with the daylight coming through the door and window. It may seem like a lot of effort, but the results show much sharper pictures and truer colours. So how do these compare with Richard's earlier attempts? John Palmer's sixth birthday party. All the usual preparations have been carried out. The cake's been baked, games have been planned, the presents wrapped, and the guests invited. But this year, there's one additional ingredient. John's parents have asked their friend Stuart Dolin along to video the occasion. Lighting, Stuart has decided that he only needs two extra desk lamps at floor level, pointing into the centre of the room to light the children's faces during the party games. To rely solely on ceiling lighting, or lamps at tabletop level, could have the effect of only illuminating the top of their heads and not their faces. Once the games get underway, the only thing to do is follow the action as it happens.
I don't think you should try and control things like this. I think you're not there to do a mega production. You're there to record the event. So if you're controlling it, then you're changing the thing completely. The only thing I would say is, again, preparation. If you know when certain specific things are about to happen, then you can be in the right place to cover them.
Birthday boy at the top. So if you want to go down, Mark, would you like to sit down that side? Nicola, over the other side with Georgia. And Laura. Lee, up next to Mark.
Johnny. I think key things to look out for are faces, reactions. Keep your shots tight in on faces. Keep your shots at their level, at their eye level. Keep them low. Don't think that just because you're an adult, everything happens from an adult point of view. A children's party is obviously for children, so pick things up from their eye point.
Oh, yeah, that's virtual.
Keep shots tight. Don't use lots of wide shots. They're boring, they don't work, they're not interesting. It's children, it's people you're interested in, it's their reactions, it's their personality.
Hold on, we'll say on three, okay? I've also said three. One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Johnny. Happy birthday to you.
Hooray!
As John's party is in November, the event's rounded off by a bonfire and fireworks. The only illumination available is from the bonfire and a patio floodlamp, so wide shots will have large dark areas and little detail, and too many of them can soon become boring. Tight shots, however, using the light from the bonfire or from fireworks, produce a magical quality all of their own. If you want to get shots where there's no other light available, a torch or two can come in very useful. And remember, don't attempt to follow rockets shooting into the sky. You'll never keep up with them. Instead, go for fireworks that are stationary. Keep the camera steady, and above all, concentrate on faces.
So, off to Malta.
I say, isn't this exciting?
Why do you do it? What do you get out of it, really?
Ego trip. No, I think everybody likes to do something constructive. And you get pleasure from what you're doing. And if the only person that you can actually involve yourself with is yourself, in other words, if you're the only person prepared to sit down in front of that camera and talk, or operate the camera or anything else, then you've got to do it on your own.
Let's go surfing now, everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
Yeah. To all that trouble?
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Why?
Because you can play television producers or whatever. It's a fun hobby, and if you're going to do it properly, then, you know, you really got to go through the whole thing. It's not just pointing a camera at something. You've got to design your background, see what it's going to look like, light it properly, get your sound balance correct, and then you should look, coming out of a television set, you should actually look as though you've taken the time and trouble to present what you're presenting to somebody else.
Oh, la vida, amore. gotta be the fool. Even everything's gone my way.
Are you regarded as a bit of an oddity in the area, then?
One of the local characters, I suppose, but then there's so many other people around here, it doesn't make any difference one way or the other.
So, it's time, really, for us to go. I'll finish off with the windsurfing film on the end. It's better seen as a complete thing. So, Davey, from Norma, and myself, and all the gang here, bye-bye. See you.
Accompanying this series is a video cassette at £9.99 and a book at £4.95, available from video shops and booksellers or direct from BBC Video and BBC Publications.